Thank you, thank you. We met in 1986, right?
Yeah.
I was 19 years old.
Yeah, I was.
He was 20.
This kid.
Oh.
Why did you sit here to believe me?
You almost got me on that one.
So you were, so the first work that here from 1976, you were?
Well, actually, the first works here is from 1975, and I was 15 years old. And it was entitled Born Again, and it was basically my re-announcement of, moving on to a new plateau of my career at that time, which was creating entire whole cars.
Yes.
And I was really, at that point, I found myself to be doing something that I thought, this is my calling.
What's one Lee Quits?
Lee Quits was one of those moments where I came back 2 minutes later, but everybody loves a comeback kid, that's why. Way before Jay-Z and Michael Jordan, but I just, in the whole graffiti subculture, someone signifying that they had quit was sort of a sad moment, and at the same time, kind of like a relief, because it was an indication that someone had run their distance and acquired and achieved something. So quitting was like a way of, a David Letterman move, just like, yeah. I've had my run. Now someone saying I'm back was even more powerful and sometimes very fearful, depending on who and what you were to most other of your peers, because some people feared guys for their reputation, but some people really admired guys for their talents. So I'm back was a way of like, now we're gonna turn it up a notch. So that was my way of like reintroducing myself to myself and to my peers, and so it was a fun moment.
I was thinking maybe the Lee Quits was like, you were 18 and like no longer a juvenile, and there must be some age where you move on to another level of punishment for illegal art activities, right?
Oh, I've been punished all my life. I laugh about it. I start most of my talks by saying I'm a recovering graffiti artist, because I'm still recovering from from a number of things, and one of them is the ignorance of people over the ages of pointing fingers, and it's always been, this is like probably one of, along with many other art movements, it's a very contested art movement from within, and people are around your very close people, close in your surroundings, are they're always pointing fingers and wondering, why are you doing that, and you shouldn't be doing that. Mainly people that are like don't have any notion of art and why art starts in the first place, and. So now I tell people, I have a little saying that I say, just because things are right now doesn't mean they were wrong then. It just means that we just knew, a very small number of us, we knew where we were going at that time. So, and it's fun to be a, sort of a rambunctious cat all your life. It makes you change.
Yeah.
Yeah, it brings change.
How old were you when you started graffiti?
I started at 14 years old, 1974, and I was very young, but I was very in tune with what was going on, not knowing how and when and who and where, but I knew there was something very off the beaten path that was happening, that was a calling that I just felt very attracted to.
But was that like a pivotal moment in graffiti? Because I remember like Norman Mailer did his book. And at that time, I used to ride the subways, and it was really about the name. It wasn't like, your generation was like the first one to have like images and things like that. I mean, how did that transition happen? Were you part of that?
I wasn't necessarily part of that in the very, very beginning stages. I came just at the right place and right time. That transition started to happen in very early 1973, where I believe that a lot of the cats that were doing the same old thing were kind of exhausting themselves and just doing the same old thing. And then some of them wanted to elaborate and put some more, to put some, to enlighten their names even more, you know, because, you know, it's such a narcissistic activity when you're just like painting your name over and over and over again. Yeah. How many times are you going to see it? How many times are you going to look at it? How many times are people going to give you embracement for it, where then it turns stale and then you have to like rejuvenate it and make it something more elaborate, more ornamental, so the letters became more colorful. Three-dimensional was introduced via through some of the, like the High School of the High School of Art and Design was very instrumental in that. But some of the cats that started the first wave of multicolor faceted pieces were from Art and Design.
You mean our public high schools were teaching vandals how to vandalize the city?
Sure was. I mean, it was. I mean, the Art and Design was a haven for a lot of. You know, I never went there. In fact, I failed my introductory test to join Art and Design. I don't know for what reason. And I also failed the one on the back of comic books with the pirate. You know, you remember that one, like with
if
the pirate.
If you could draw this.
If you could draw this, yeah. You'll win whatever. And I failed that. And I was like, you know, I was, you know, and it was way before I started painting on the trains. And I was like perplexed. I was like, no, I drew it just as it was on the paper. How could I fail? It was perfect. And, you know, I think it was going into that systematic way of painting along with a lot of peers that you didn't necessarily know or would ever know. It was a camaraderie that was like very, it was very heartfelt. You felt like you was part of a big thing that no one really necessarily knew what it could be. You know, there was no manifesto, there was no announcement, here we are, this is what we're about. So it was very unique. I'm sorry, I'm probably steering away from the...
No.
Going back to 73, 74, a lot of things started to come alive. And the two guys that I remember, actually I have to say three guys. There was one gentleman by the name of Vinny that painted his name everywhere. The same style, the same font on all the A's and the double A's back then, the double C's and the double E's. And I was like, why? What is that? The V, and then I see an I, and then it looked like two N's that look like A's, like lowercase A's. And I was like, what's that? How could that spell anything? I didn't know it said Vinny. And that was my first visual remembrance of graffiti on the subways. Just the curiosity behind that. And then behind that, I started to, of course, I had a keen look for what was going on, and I discovered more expressionistic painters like Cliff 159 and more pop painters like Blade One. And those are the two guys that I wanted to emulate. They were like my unsung heroes that I was like, I have to paint like these guys.
Because did you meet them?
I met them years later, many years later.
How much older were they than you?
They were like 5-6 years older than I am, more or less. They were painting elaborate whole cars, entire 50-foot length whole cars. And I was like, wow, you know, that's the presentation right there. That's the stage opener to exorcise yourself out of the norms and the sort of the alphabet soup, as I called it. Everybody was just painting their names everywhere, and I was like, I want to do quality. I don't want to do quantity. And that was the drive behind me, and it was ironic to most painters, writers at that time, as we call it. Like, why are you spending one night, 8 hours, 10 hours at the most, in one spot when you can get more push for your buck by going through all the lanes, putting your name very small and very faintly on every car? I was like, no, I want people to remember that one car.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I was watching the Anthony Bourdain show on CNN the other night, and he was in the Bronx with Futura, and they were up on top of a building, and Futura said, this was my theater. We used to come up here and watch the trains go by. Mm. And I could imagine that was pretty amazing. I mean, even when they came into the station, you know, you like wanted to applaud sometimes.
Oh, it was such a fascinating point in time. I mean, I created a painting called Benchmark based on the actual station where most of us congregated and sort of hung out and critiqued each other and had fist fights, you know, over anything, over paint. You went over my name by that much. I'm punching you in your face. Give me some paint for that. It was like it was kind of hostage exchange place. And it was basically almost like, I mean, you could think about the Dadaists, you know, like they were hanging out in bars, you know, in small bars in Switzerland and probably having their little like arguments and critiquing each other about art and what is art and what are they about. Same thing with us, you know, we were all like really developing our sense in a very closed-minded environment,
yeah.
Basically, because none of us cared or even dared to even think about art outside of what we were doing. We were like, how could you think about creating art when you're doing it? You're creating it.
Right.
So you don't think about anything other than the moment, the heat of the moment. So yeah, it was a very fascinating moments in those places where the conversation would literally roll into you and then roll out. And you could just see the buzz, you know, like when something exciting came up and you was like, oh my God, there it is. Or, whoa, you know, the first moment of discovery was monumental. You couldn't put it in a, you couldn't capture it anyway, but being there.
And did you do the 5 train? Because that was like the convenient yard to you?
It wasn't convenient. As a austere, the environment that those yards were, you know, the number five train was, they were parked in the most outskirts parts of the city, you know, either in the upper North Bronx or the burnt out, blighted East New York section and Bed-Stuy. So I lived right here in the Lower East Side. I had no proximity to them, to those places where some guys could literally step out of their door and they could see the yard across the street or the layup or what. So I had to travel 1 hour, 2 hours sometimes with bags of paint covertly, you know, dressed up, you know, totally, you know, suit and tie. Like I had a whole methodical, you know, way of doing it via true comic book characters and, you know, superheroes of being anonymous and then saving the world. And I would go to these yards and then change into this ninja kind of like very elastic cat, you know. And I would do that in the North Bronx. And the 5 train was so monumental because my first train that I remember seeing a Vinny was an F train. And the real vivid memories I remember of the F train was like, wow, a subway that comes from the inner city and ends up on the beach. What a beautiful, like, transition for the train. And then when you see those names on those trains on Coney Island from Nathan, it's so magical. And then I was like, I want to paint the F train, which was very close to my, where they ran, they were very close to my home. But then I figured out very quickly that the masters were on the number 5 by, you know, I don't know, you know, happenstance. They were the 5s. And then I quickly mapped it out and said, wow, the 5 goes right through Wall Street, through the heart of Wall Street, through the heart of Midtown, the financial district, through all the districts that are of interest, you know, people outside of the perimeter of, like, you know, regular New Yorkers, and then ends up in the North, blue chip, working class New York, and ends up in the blighted, poverty strewn. I was like, I want to paint that train. And then by chance, I, you know, got, you know, kind of like welded to the hip to the rest of the Fabulous 5, which was a group of 5 of us that painted just whole cars.
How did you meet them? Did you meet them at the yards or?
It's a long story. I was painting whole cars. By late 75, I was already pulling off whole cars on my own solo, and I brought them out of you know, they had retired because they had been painting since the early 70s. And they were all, except for the one another member, they were all ex-gang members. They were, you know, members of the Black Spades, the Puerto Rican Brothers, and the Ghetto Brothers, and the Savage Skulls. And they started seeing these trains as well, these whole cars. And it was, you know, it tantalized them enough to like, who is this guy and, you know, why and where. And I didn't realize that I was turning into that character, that I was now being that very shadowy character for obvious reasons. And they seeked me out. They traveled everywhere. And by chance, they missed me everywhere I went. There's a Leo car. And they would touch the car, and it was fresh paint, and it was sticky. And I was just shadowily, you know, just walking away. And, you know, I had a practice of, like, I never wanted to be seen by other graffiti writers because I thought that they, as close as they were, some of them, I never wanted to let it be known. Like, we saw Lee in the New Lots yard, you know, on Saturday night, because and then that pattern can be totally followed by the police.
Yeah.
So I always kept very, you know, I diverted people. I would say, hey, yo, I'm painting in Baychester tonight, Bronx. And then I would go to Brooklyn deliberately. So, you know, if there was any dime dropping or any, like, what I call friendly fire, it's like, oh, I just saw Lee. Guess where he's going? He's pulling a whole car tonight. Where is he? He's in Baychester. And if there was some, you know, authority there with big ears, they'll be like, we know where to go. And then I'd be on the other side within the gunshots, painting, you know, in the safest place in the world, the yards.
Oh. Did you ever get caught?
I never got caught. I got harassed. They followed me. They staked out my parents' apartment in the projects, yeah. right there at the foot of the Brooklyn Bridge. And
was this like after you got publicity for like Wild Style and stuff? Or?
No, this was late 78,
yeah.
77, 78. They were following me. They were staking me out. They were there were dime droppers at that time that were, and I knew who they were. I'm proud to say I was born in the year of the rat, and the rat always knows. The rat always knows. And I could see someone's eyes and read them, do a whole reconnaissance on like their character, and I was like, that guy's a rat. You know, I'm a rat that knows a rat. So I kept very secret for that, but they knew who I was. They harassed me. I got, you know, I had some moments with a few of them that were, you know, old enough not to run fast enough to be able to get anyone. And, you know, they pretty much slapped me around, you know, physically, you know, kind of slapped me around.
Yeah.
And, you know, I took out my revenge the next day, you know, just like getting more elaborate and more colorful. So, it was, you know, it was great.
And so how did the style, Wild Style, come about? I mean,
the concept of the film or the...
No.
Oh, Wild Style. The, well, I think early on, I mean, that's a loaded question within a lot of writers, but, you know, early on in the you know, early 70s, 73, maybe even possibly 72, I think the origins can be really tied to either the Bronx or Brooklyn because of the very calligraphy, very, you know, very ornamental tagging styles that, you know, guys like the ex-Vandals and, you know, the Ebony Dukes and people like that had in the tag, which is a simplistic signature.
Yeah.
And that morphed into like, oh, let's just duplicate this in a masterpiece. And then those names started to have, you know, everyone has a unique signature, a unique underscore, a unique dot.
Yeah.
You know, exclamation point, or so on and so forth. So I think that certain letters lend themselves by virtue of the name, the way it sounded. Some of my favorite names is like Super Strut, Super Cool. Really like names of that era, you know, that could lend themselves by the way the letter was just by the name itself, the way the letter could be more exciting, could be more, you know, jazzy. And so an R that has, you know, I'm doing it backwards now for the audience, the R that just goes like that can now have a trucking stem that curls around. Now that R becomes characteristic of the person that's creating it. You know, I've just thought about this for many years now.
Yeah.
Like Wild Style, I think, was created by a number of reasons all coming into a perfect storm. I think it was first style and wanting to outdo each other and upstage most cats on the subway. But I think that a lot of the masters of wild style were actually two-dimensional sculptors in their own right, and they didn't even realize, and probably still don't,
yeah.
because they took the letter and reformed it into having and armed it and reshaped it to become a caricature of maybe their broken homes or their neighborhoods or their or the social economic issues that were inflicting everyone. It's like, why make my name, as compared to mine, which was very legible and very bland maybe and very blocky, some guys were like, I want to make my name look dangerous because yeah. it comes from a dangerous place. And it should have that reflection of that dangerous place. So in a way, it's a very sincere way of addressing your issues that are going at hand at the moment.
But do you think, like, when you look at, like, these older pieces here on the wall in the back, obviously there's a big, you know, like, sort of cartoon influence and superheroes and Marvel and all that. I think that's part of it, of the, you know, sort of aesthetic lineage of graffiti?
Characters started coming.
Or the hot rod thing?
Yeah, I mean, they started coming into play just because I think guys wanted to bring an atmosphere, a happening to their work, you know, maybe a supporting cast.
Yeah.
And I looked at it as a supporting cast. Like, I wanted to have caricatures that in turn over the years turned into stories and then into political statements as a sort of sort of a prelude to sort of like a primary thing as opposed to, and the name becoming secondary, the name just for the signature. And the primary thing for myself, I can't speak for everyone, was to create storytelling on the subways. And I just was so in love with the shape, the rectangular shape and the possibilities of that shape and the effect that it had on people so fast that I felt like, why should my name just take up all this real estate? Why not address something else that is very dear to me, you know, the post-Vietnam era? You know, Vietnam just virtual, you know, literally had yeah. just ended, you know, that year, 75 or so. And then the civil rights movement and a number of movements that were all clashing and, you know, people were in the streets. And those things, like, I really, you know, contradictory to what I was learning in Catholic school, you know, I was like, you know, I wanted to sarcastically address what was being the doctrine that was being thrown at me. I wanted to readdress it in a very funny way, in a very immediate way. And as for me, for doing whole cars, I just felt that the cartoons represented, the superheroes represented who I felt to myself as a superhero within myself. Because I had discovered myself as an artist at that point. I was like, I know I'm an artist. I know, and that's why I continue to do this. It's not an act of vandalism is something that you kind of do. It's very vile and it's yeah. very, and you never think about it again. You just like kind of, you know, and you forget about it. I believe a true act of vandalism is something that happens and then maybe just goes away and you just never think of it. You never think it through. Whereas something that you develop and you continue to redevelop and critique it and share it, it's something else than that. And I just felt like this is a conversation that's very elastic, it's very long, and it's it deserves, you know, it just deserves more space and more color, you know, and more, you know.
But I mean, vandalism is like an aggressive thing, and I think that, I mean, graffiti as we know it in New York, I don't think was ever like about that, you know, unless you tag somebody's car or something, you know. Like,
right.
But it was more about like sort of showing, marking your turf, no? I mean, like, because like these guys, like, the older, you know, like Stay High and Taki 183, it was like kind of astounding how much territory they covered, right? And then you guys moved on to something else. It wasn't just about range, but it was about like just the you know, effect, power of the image.
Yeah, I mean, well, the subways were a great vehicle, literally, to have your work, you know, go from one end to the other. So you broaden your range of your work now being seen. I don't even think most of us at an early stage in the Stay High days, I don't think they even realized how much of an effect they had on the city itself. That this this phenomenon was taking hold. You know, maybe when you heard it from someone from Bed-Stuy coming to you, like, oh, I saw that train. I don't think it really registered, because it looked like the subway was just so integrated to your conditions that you didn't think that it was really literally a vehicle that was reaching someone young, your age or younger or older, in another part of town that you would necessarily not even meet under normal conditions, and that they were like acknowledging your existence in this loud, you know, city that we live in.
Yeah.
Thank God it's loud, because it just makes everybody reinvent themselves, right? So I think the whole staking your flag was more, I think that goes way back to like gang territory stuff, yeah, which had absolutely nothing to do with why people of talent and people that didn't even know they had talent were getting into this movement that felt more of a benevolent act. It was more of a benevolent act than as an act of like, you know, I'm doing this just to annoy municipality. No, I'm doing this because I want to rebuild myself. I want to rebuild my existence in this mess, you know. So, you know, I grew up in a very buck wild neighborhood, and, you know, where police didn't even want to come, emergency calls. And, you know, there were lots of things that, you know, were instrumental in lots of people's, you know, falling south. But I just felt like this was a way of, like, having a voice that, you know, had relevance, you know. And, you know, like, art affixes itself. I feel that art, in general, affixes itself to times, circumstances, and events, you know. And sometimes it kind of has an inextricable connection to why it's happening, and maybe even have responsibility, you know, it's responsible for why it's happening. But the fact is, like, you know, like movements of art during the, you know, for the ages have all happened either because of reflection from another art movement or an extension of that conversation, or as a sort of like, oh, we don't believe in that. Well, you know, the futurists were different from the Dadaists, you know, and maybe abstract, you know, the abstract artists may not have come if it wasn't for that before them. And graffiti, it's hard to imagine graffiti without, you know, without blight and, you know, blight and poverty and necessity, you know, and for economical and social inequalities that were happening to a lot of young people. Whereas other art movements were about art, and they were aware about art, and there were older gentlemen and women that were like aware of what they were doing. But these were young people as early as 12, 13, 14 years old saying, we're gonna change something in this mess, you know. And what a rescue mission that was, you know.
I always thought of graffiti as a way of like people humanizing the urban environment, because if it wasn't for graffiti, what do you have? You have Chase, you know, you have Exxon, you have all these corporations with their names all over the place, but we're the people, you know, and it was a way of saying, you know, we live here, and, you know, this is what the city is.
True, and I beg to differ about, like, you know, back then, as you know, the city was, I felt a little bit, you know, times were crazy, but things were great, right? I mean, you could work a job, you know, on a corner somewhere and make your rent, right? And there were mom and pop gas stations everywhere, and now it's, you know, I feel like there's this infestation of like alienation, you know, and I just feel like people are more disconnected now than ever, and maybe for that reason it still festers on the street. But I think back then was like a calling, like an outcry of like, you know, look at this mess, you know, we're part of it, so we're going to rebuild it on our own terms, under our own conditions, and under any means necessary. Conceptually, just it's such a genius idea to like take a moving object that is very fleeting and create something that's very ephemeral, you know, like for for hours on end, and you never know if you're going to see it again, if it's ever going to be embraced, and but you just felt it, that it was like that one little cog that you actually turned. You turned the wheels, and you felt better about your. I returned from the North Bronx, which is a very scary place, because the very scary part of the North Bronx was, I would go to the South Bronx on the first car of the train. I always needed to have my meditation moment with my bags of pain, and look, and it was really beautiful. There was something beautiful of the warm glows and glares in the night sky in the South Bronx, and they were all burning tournaments. So they were like candles everywhere. They were burning down. And I was going through this gauntlet of like waste, and then ending up in an upper middle class neighborhood where people were like, what's that kid doing here? You know, at 2 a.m. And that was the most scariest part. And when I went there, I went into that sanctuary of the trains and felt, this is where I feel I can bring something back home with me the next morning, go back into that mess, and, you know, and say, I have a vested interest in the world outside with something that I've created that is not necessarily part of, you know, the notion of like, wow, this should happen. It did happen. So, I don't know. So, I felt better. I felt more relieved coming back. You know, and of course, when you get embraced by your peers, you know, you get that kind of like exchange, and you know, you just feel like, oh man, I'm totally invincible, and I can do this again. And at that point, not realizing that the influence, the power behind that influence, was like beyond, you know, what I could ever think of. You know, and here now it is global, right?
Yeah. But when you first realized that, did you? I mean, had you ever thought about where is this all going? What am I going to do? You know, I'm an artist. What am I going to do after this? You know, how long am I going to do this?
I early on in 1978, I felt that the trains were already like, okay, what have I done that I, you know, what have I not done that or has been done already? I was like, I need to go somewhere more challenging. The challenging place to me was literally above ground. Yeah. I went to the streets and I created the first full handball court mural, yeah, top to bottom, 1978. That was the moment that I actually said to myself, looking at the wall, daydreaming with it, night and day, in and out, just saying, wow, I have arrived as an artist.
Yeah.
Because now I took the work to a point place where people could dissect it and people can digest it, you know, and it wouldn't run away from them. And what was that? You know, wow, what a beautiful banquet, like, yeah, Klaus Oldenburg said. What a beautiful blank banquet of flowers, you know, and it goes in and out. It's almost like a blind date, right? And here is as a handball court where I'm more vulnerable, but I'm also more open to having a conversation about art, you know, and the composition is different and the size is different, the chances are different. And, you know, I'm working with a ladder for the first time ever. I'm working with community for the first time ever. I'm now being exposed to the community that embraced me that morning. I'll never forget that. With tea and cups of coffee and bagels and all kinds. I mean, everyone, police officers, hey, you know, and because it looked legit. I totally planned it to look legit. And it was totally illegal. And I was like, I'm going to get away with this. And hence, you know, Keith Haring and Jean Michel, and they come to these things, and number of, you know, hundreds and now thousands of young people that came up to those walls, and just, you know, I don't know why they couldn't imagine that could happen. And, you know, sometimes when you do things and you're like, wow, how did I do that? How did I pull, yeah, that off? And I don't even remember doing that. And I can imagine what it could have been to the viewer, even as another artist, going, this is like to another level. This is something, you know, not to, you know, pat myself, but I felt like this is a moment, it's a pivotal moment that now is, let's change the envelopes, let's change the address.
Yeah.
This is now going to the Whitney. You know, this is, you know, not going to the North Bronx anymore.
Because the only voice was, this is like bad, this is vandalism, and then you had support from, you know, neighbors and people even in the art world, right?
So. Yeah, I mean, when you think about even Andy Warhol being embraced by cats like, you know, Irving Blum and Peggy Guggenheim, you know, embracing artists way before they were, and they were in a really comfortable, I would say a comfortable environment, you know, like we were literally anonymous cats coming out like the mold people, and, you know, we're all of a sudden in cocktail society.
Yeah.
You know, the lights come on and we're like, whoa, what, you know, what's, you know, you come from the darkness, you know, sheer darkness where you're working with small incandescent lighting every other 100 feet, and you come into this celebrative, you know, this festive point, and it was very confusing, but it was so monumental for people like, you know, Diego Cortez and Patty Astor and Jeffrey Deitch, and, you know, and now even Nicole Klaxberg, you know, just like, just taking, you know, yeah, it's like sometimes it takes, you know, like that distance of time for people to say, first of all, this ain't going away. And why is it still here? And why has it changed itself so many times to the point that not only the practitioners that came to New York School, as they call it, are, you know, very few, unfortunately, far in between, that are really conceptually incredible artists outside of the world of subways.
Yeah.
But now that so many voices are coming from worlds and times that weren't even around when we were painting trains. You know, really established great artists that are coming from other countries and different age groups that are discovered through books and folklore and all that, and like now have a voice because it did the same thing that Cliff and Blade did for me in 1974. And that's amazing.
But also, when you guys arrived, it was a very dry moment in the art world, you know? I mean, like, you know, you go into a gallery and there's like a lot of lumber on the floor or, you know, a couple of I-beams, and so it kind of revivified painting in a way. And then Jean came along, and he was doing graffiti, but he only did it in neighborhoods where there were galleries.
Right. Strategic cat, he was.
But I think it changed the atmosphere. I mean, somebody like Futura, you know, I mean, he could have, you know, just made canvases, but I mean, you know, he wanted to get it out there, and that was the way to get it out there, right?
It was. It was, I mean, the amount of work and energy that you threw at those trains, there's no way you can come out of that atmosphere and come out into the world and be stunned, other than maybe emotional, but physically, you're like, oh, yeah, it's about product placement. That's what it becomes. It's about, I know where to strategically, where this work, this name, or whatever, will make the most impact to the most people in one moment, in one New York moment. So you found your ways of, you know, some of us steered towards the fine arts because that was the way of, like, you know, preserving your work and maybe changing your work, which is very heroic. We were well-versed in, like, yeah, where do you put your stuff for the most impact? You know?
So how did you get discovered by Hollywood? I mean, Charlie Ahern.
Charlie may add to this. Charlie was by chance, you know, working on film projects, his own film projects in my neighborhood, by chance, and started to see my name and my work, you know, peppered around the neighborhood, and, you know, out of curiosity, who's this cat? Same thing like the Fat Five did. Who's this cat? Who's this? And by the way, when the Fat Five met me, they looked down at me. I was looking up at them. I was a little shrimp, and all these, you know, wearing the chingaling, like the colors, you know, axes, you know, like tomahawks. And I'm like, you know, combat boots, the, you know, the hats. I was like, oh, you know, and they're looking at me, and they're like, you're doing that work? And they thought I was this 10-foot dude. That was the power of those trains. Like, no kid could have done this that was any taller than, you know, any shorter than 10 foot. And you know, it just painted that picture. But Charlie, I guess the picture that was painted in his face was like, who is this cat? And people were like, yeah, you know, maybe you might want to add, he rides around in a little motorcycle, and you got to grab him whenever you can, you know, like throw him off the bike or something. And then he found me. I was. A mini bike.
A little mini bike
with the lawnmower.
It was a thing that you made yourself.
Yes.
It was a homemade.
A homemade chopper mini bike.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you had a, and you were, for me, you were tall and skinny, and you had a big afro.
I did.
And.
Thank God for Afro Sheen.
Slippery. You were slippery. In other words, you were. Yeah. Perfectly, you know, I said, you made this, looking at the Howard the Duck mural, which you had just made, 78. Mm. I said, you made this, and I said, how can I, I'd like to work with you, how can I hook up with you? And you go, I'll be around, and then he's like, and then it disappears, and that was it, honestly.
It is true, yeah.
Did you think Charlie was a cop?
No, I didn't think he was really a cop. I just thought, whoa. You know, I mean, at that, you know, that was, and that was just the year before, you know, Claudio Bruni, which was my first art dealer, you know, came to, you know, to bring us to the next level. You know, anyone outside of the, you know, out of the world of people that in the know was like very suspect to me.
Yeah.
So I was like, he's probably an informant for the cops maybe, but he's not a cop. You know, I can read cops a mile away. And a DT, as we used to call him back then. And, you know, I just was like, okay, cool. What's this guy, you know, why is he... You know, and then I don't know. I mean, we met over, you know, we met a couple occasions, art shows. No.
I met you in 78 with your souped up bike.
Right.
And the very next thing that happened was Fred Bradway came to the Times Square show.
Right.
And he mentioned that he was trying to work with you on some things, and I said, bring Lee here tomorrow morning as a painted mural on the building out front.
Right.
A fat five, which you did.
Right.
A fat 5-year-old. And this is completely illegal on someone else's building. In the middle of Times
Square. Well, it was on the building itself, at Times Square. Yeah.
In daylight, without permission or anything. And that was it. And I thought in my own mind that we were working on making a movie.
Right, and you know, at that moment...
You didn't have a contract, but it was like you, me, and Fred, and I thought, okay, now we're starting.
Right.
We're doing
right.
It.
Yeah.
That was it.
Yeah.
No discussion. Right?
Yeah.
No.
In a nutshell.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, working with Charlie, I mean, in a very, monumental film, now that we've got that much distance, it was, you know, I was a bit of a diva. For obvious reasons, I didn't want to, you know, I was still active. You know, when I was with Barbara Gladstone at that time, I was still active on the subways. I was painting by day in, you know, any studio environment, and then painting at night on the subways. So, you know, I was very elusive even with Barbara. She was like, how do you paint? I was like, don't worry about it. I'll bring the paintings in tomorrow. And, you know, with Charlie, I was like, no, this is going to be a film project that's going to expose everything that I'm about. So it was very little... you know, so I was like, no, if you're filming in the subways, I can't be there. You have to get it, you know, I'm not going to be there. And he had to, you know, get doubles.
To
Don D became my double. An incredible artist, you know. Much props to Don D. He's an amazing artist. You know, he's one of my top 10 on the list as conceptual, you know, great artist. Yeah.
So what caused New York style graffiti to spread across the world?
You know, I mean, there was a little snippet of it happening with the Norman Mailer book and stuff, and a few other books that people don't really give too much credit to, which is Craig Castleman's Getting Up book, yeah. Which I did an interview for, and I kind of diverted on some of the facts, again, just to steer people away. But what really, really blew the whole thing, you know, erupted the whole thing was, I would have to say, a combination of things. The Perfect Storm, the film Wild Style, the documentary Style Wars, and the book Subway Art by Henry Chalfant and, yeah. and Martha Cooper. That was the Bible across the globe. And they didn't sell many copies, but they made 50 reruns of them. Why? They were the most lifted books in all of Europe.
Yeah.
Every young person was seen, got their eyes, you know, had their eyes on that book, and it was appropriated in within seconds. And then it was handed out everywhere, and they were like, what is going on in New York? This is phenomenal. And this is like a stagnant pictures now of subways. But for some reason, there was a connection of, you know, like, we need to be part of this. This is even bigger than New York.
But it's kind of amazing how, like, it's still, you take a train in Europe, man, and it's like everywhere. In the United States, not so much, right?
In the United States, not so much. And, you know, I think, you know, there's a number of contested reasons why it stopped on the subways. Yeah, we eradicated the whole thing because, you know, we got our program system, you know, the police did more work and this, that, and all. It's probably the best tangible thing that politicians ever had, you know, to say they got rid of graffiti. But the thing is that graffiti didn't rid itself of itself. It re-manifested, it reinvented itself. So when the same cat, when cats were saying, it's over, we've succeeded in the war against graffiti, it was at that pivotal time that some of the major practitioners were transitioning to fine arts.
Yeah.
So the steerage was not, all of a sudden, the wheel of the ship went, okay, freak that iceberg, we're going to this one, and it was a perfect mating of circumstances. Like, let's move now to the subway. So, to the fine arts and canvas and walls and things like that. And I just feel that you know, Europe, it was such a natural thing because Europe has such a deep history, rich history, hundreds and hundreds of years of art. America is still such a young pup, you know, and. And, you know, it's a great venue for art because of all the crazy, you know, chaotic, you know, mess that this country can have underneath. It creates really great art. And I think it was a perfect calling for this movement to, you know, make those small steps to become now a major player in the influence of how work is applied, how it's presented. You know, I mean, Jenny Holzer, I mean, there's one of my favorite conceptual artists that, like, said, I'm taking to the streets, you know, with my work early on in the late, you know, in the 70s, in the late 70s, and Kiki Smith and, you know, Judy Rivka, you know, all those people that, you know, people have forgotten for the most part. And they were doing things, street art, way before even the term was even, you know, imagined. And it was because of that, like, hey, this alternative way of making your statement. And of course, that led over to establishments like Fun Gallery and PPOW, you know, Semaphore East, you know, creating galleries outside of the sector of, you know, the fine arts, you know, planet. And
yeah.
it was, you know, it enabled a lot of things to come into play. Yeah.
Maybe some people have questions.
Sure.
I'm curious, I'd like to hear you talk about specifically about your transition to canvas. And, you know, from working on 50 feet of steel to a piece of canvas. I know, for instance, that you painted in, you didn't have a studio, so you would paint in your room, you would paint in City Hall Station, places like that. But I'm interested not just where you painted, but how, because you weren't painting feet on campus like some guys,
right.
You were doing other things. Say something about that.
Yeah, I again, you know, I was kind of like bored with my name and, you know, trying to kind of kneel that thing into something. And I felt, you know, I just want to elaborate more on, like, issues at hand at that moment, and I just felt like more, you know, composing a piece on a piece of canvas or even a wall was more challenging for me at that point, because now it was not going to focus much on the name and the crutch that the name gives the piece. Now I have to have a comprehensive, like a very, intense conversation in the canvas, and I really need to talk about it, you know, with color formation. And sometimes, you know, now I'm more, I mean, like this is a brand new work from last year, and I'm more minimal now. I'm more, because I just feel like I want to say more with less, whereas at that time, even on the first canvases, I wanted to do more with more. And it was because of that ephemeral, you know, environment you come from. You never know if you're going to see your work again on the trains. Someone's going to go over it, which rarely happened with works of mine and other masters that kind of like had a name. But you just felt detached from your work on the subways, where on the canvas you was more sincere and you lived with your work. And I feel that that's the responsibility of any artist, that they need to live with their work, and they just need to be true to that moment. Because that moment is only, you know, you arrest it once and then it's gone too, you know. But the canvas survives, you know. So
I have one follow-up is, like, I know that some of the early paintings were, like, the painting we have at the museum, Light Face Light, and it's about, to me, it's about what you saw in the Lower East Side in the early 1980s. Was that, I didn't get to see that show, unfortunately, but was the work in that show kind of more about your life and your life at the time?
Yes, it was direct experiences that I witnessed, or, you know, just overheard, and just wanted to, you know, be sort of like the tracer to stories that I heard. So, you know, it was my first time painting on really fine linen, again, huge, which I loved, I still do. And, you know, it was my second show with Barbara Gladstone, and it was a monumental show. It really was like a departure for me at that time. And that was back in 1984. And that was a time where writers were, like, still painting trains. I still was. But it was like I was in this kind of, like, seesaw kind of situation where, you know, what am I in love with here? What's my calling? Obviously, the fine arts, you know, took over from that point. Hey.
I would not describe your work, the more famous, the stuff that correlates to the stuff on the wall, that wild style. You started out doing some burners that were, like, you know, in code, like, for writing for other writers to impress them.
And they were
at some
hurt.
Point, you decided that I'd rather communicate with the public more than other writers. What made you go in a different direction when you could have evolved? You had the talent to really, you know, mix it up where only writers could be able to write.
I just felt that that small umbrella where we all kind of like hid under was a little too small for what I wanted to really, you know, do. And I just felt like, Jesus, the peripheral audience that we had, 8 million people at that point, you know, 2 million of them each and every day are looking at you, witnessing your work. Like, why not cater to that and try to open up? I guess that was my first, you know, very early on. It was my way of, like, I really want to talk with the cats that discount me and shun me away, that throw me to the back of the bus or under the bus or whatever, and bring, you know, a conversation that, do you really think that this could be, is this an act of vile vandalism? You know, like, why not look at this, you know, this piece as something of a voice? And I just felt that writers were too much self-engulfed in the development of their name, which was a beautiful movement. The Wild Style movement was a movement within the movement. To this day, I believe that. But I wanted to, since I was a storyteller by heart, I was like, I need to open that aperture, you know, and just have more of a bigger conversation, and maybe learn things from the exchange back and forth, even if it's negative. And I just felt, I had a lot of fun just watching people's reactions on the platforms, you know. And there was only one time where the whole station, or a good part of the station, went into applaud. They went into a complete applaud. I'll never forget that. With a police officer standing in the middle of the crowd on Brooklyn Bridge Station when the whole train pulled in to the station. And it was 10 cars painted end to end, the whole entire train. And it must have been a point where people said, wow, the city commissioned the first master. So they went into full applaud, and I was like stunned by the applause. I was like, and I watched the cop just like, you know, he was like, he was trying to break at the seams. He wanted to laugh and like really embrace it. But, and I watched him, and I watched him, and I was like, oh, you know, at that point, I was like, yeah, this is it. This is the audience, you know, and the writers will be there. They'll be there anyway, because they're always popping shit and, you know, getting involved with each other. You know, it's great. It's a great brotherhood, you know. Yeah.
I just want to come back to this whole thing about your, like, the use of your name. You talked about how you downplayed it relative to other writers, and how it, you know, you kind of have a back and forth relationship with using it. But one of the things that strikes me, and how a lot of people, you know, a lot of the names came sort of from almost like a gang tradition, but really you're one of the only writers who actually used your name rather than a nickname or a tag. Was there something distinctive about, you know, using Lee as your name to, you know, not making something up and using that kind of fit with that?
Simple. I hated my first name. You know, Jorge Lee Quiñones. I just hated my first name. It's like, Mom, can you have been a little bit more, you know, a little bit more original?
But a lot of people didn't use their names at all. They made something up. They came up with a nickname or, you know.
Right. And some people did, you know, but people came with nicknames because it was a common practice on the street to have a slick, you know, kind of like cool name, you know, like Super Strut, like I said, and Super Cool and Stay High. And, you know, just, but there were guys that had their real names, like Lionel. And, you know, there's a number of people that use their real names just because maybe they just felt that they wanted to be that much closer to their real identity.
That's but, what I'm asking.
Yeah, the identity, it was an identity crisis, right? That's what, this is what really it is. It's an identity crisis within youth in New York City in the early 70s, thank God for that. And the diversion was like, let's build up our own names and let's make up names that make us bigger than ourselves via true superheroes or TV, popular culture, whatever. And I sound cooler to someone, you know, if I was to take someone's name, if I can come up, I sound cooler by the name of All Jive 161, All Jive. It's like, whoa, as opposed to Michael. Sorry, no point, you know, like, it was like that kind of thing, like, God, you know, like, you just wanted to, there was something more to the name, the letters, the placement, the way they kind of interlocked with each other and made it more attractive to make that name into a sculpture or a movie. And then the kinetic, the energy of the subways made the names and the characters come alive. You could see a train. The movement was lost when you went to canvas, but there was more that went to canvas that could not be explained on the train. So it was a nice, good hostage exchange, as I call it, you know. On the trains, the Silver Surfer, you know, some Jack Kirby, you know, Stan Lee characters would definitely come so vividly alive as they went on the station. And, you know, he's just flying across on his surfboard, and it's like, whoa! And it's on the express train. It's amazing. It's just, rah, you know, and then you never see it again. And it's like, what was that? You know, it was great. It was funny. This Rose.
I sort of like to talk a little bit about your evolution as an artist, like being through these walls and these works and the work around you, and like there's letters totally different. It feels like, you know, at one point you're like going against the law, you're doing this thing, you have to be on pure instinct, pure adrenaline, partly, right? And then now you're on canvas and all these years later, and this work looks very vulnerable, it looks
good question. You know, difficult at times, you know, because I'm more, you know, my finger is on my own pulse when I'm making canvas, because I'm more aware of like the things that affect me and the things that affect people around me and just, you know, the pulse of life. So I tend to find it more challenging here and probably even more daring and scary, you know, frightening than I was on the subways, because I can hide under the cloak of darkness and anonymous, you know, figure, oh, you know, and just the spectacle of a subway car coming into a station made you a superstar overnight. And that was enough to make everyone say, great, oh, wow, cool, he's on the charts, he's on the top charts. But here, you're now working in a more intimate environment and you're talking with people even about very similar issues, and you're working with different materials and you're working against the grain of graffiti lore, like keep it real, keep the name, keep, and those stagnant, you know, practices that I feel at this point, 40 years after the fact, have to be, you know, they need to be, you know, those molds need to be broken. And I think the most daring thing that any artist, musician, poet, writer, filmmaker will do is to challenge the status quo of their peers and what they think is comfortable, and maybe fail once in a while to achieve something at some point that you feel you feel a new decibel to you, what you're saying. You know, there's a new revitalized and very important, something that makes you feel that you are at your moment, that you're not living a nostalgic moment for nostalgic reasons and like, hey, trading baseball cards. You know, it's not about that. That's all great. And there's some great stories that are yet to be told. But I think when you go out on limbo on yourself, by yourself, with yourself, there's a lot of things that are very uncomfortable, and I feel comfortable being uncomfortable. You know, it's like an oxymoron of like, you know, I mean, people call us graffiti artists. Graffiti? But you're calling us also an artist. So that's weird. You know, like, are we vandals or are we artists? So as a painter, I just feel like, am I a true practitioner? No, I feel that I've just like, I've turned that page. I'm in a different chapter that could be very uncomfortable. Here's my first collaboration with my mother's recipe writings from the 70s and the 80s. And I just felt that the issues that we had not addressed needed to be addressed by forming letters, you know, with her letters, but forming something that I felt that she was, you know, maybe embracing and maybe arrested by, you know, and I was arrested by it because we never had that, you know, let's go for the Dukes, you know, over the table. And now at her age and my age, I felt that we can arrive at that conversation, and I could arrive with that conversation to this painting. And it was, you know, it was a process. And, you know, I mean, that's the way I approach my work. You know, it sounds boring and maybe sounds a little too academic or whatever, but I just feel like, sometimes I just feel like I'm just, you know, I want to paint a straight line. And, you know, I don't think anyone can ever paint a straight line. No one can ever paint a straight line to save their lives. So I just feel like if a straight line is too straight, you're dead. If it's erratic, you're alive. There's a pulse, you know? So.
I always felt like when we go to each other, just one day, hopefully, the other day, and I always felt that there was like the relationship with standards and the comments. But when you read, you know, Williams Burroughs, and of course, you think about the combat of the landscape and letters and grammar, and making work, sort of people putting life and limb on it. I'd love to hear, I mean, we were talking about the Hyundai, you know, there's the whole sense of like the next generation of people who, you know, to me at least, you guys are part of both the legacy of critique of the landscape, control, you know, kind of intervention. So what do you think of some of the newer artists, of course, like Banksy, Cobb, Chef Perry, Mr. Brainwash, all of whom I think at least have dealt with some of the issues by appropriating? But I'd love to just hear maybe both of you kind of talk about the more contemporary update, just see what's going on.
Wow. Okay. Would you...
Every day I think about unfollowing Banksy. I mean, something's stopping me, but I don't know.
Wow, that was a good one.
I last week I put on Twitter, Banksy is no Mort Walker. I don't know if anybody, he's the guy that did Beetle Bailey, but I don't know. I see a lot of stuff on the street, like a lot of kind of printed stuff that I think is interesting. Mm. I mean, to me, I think the most interesting stuff on the walls now is kind of pasted up there, right?
Right, right.
But I don't know. Mm.
I think the result of some of those artists, you know, they are a result of what I call a ready-made world. Almost like, again, like the way Man Ray or Duchamp would have, you know, they've taken things that you would think, oh, what are you going to do with a bicycle seat or a toilet or whatever, and you see something else in it. Now that we're so over spoon-fed with advertisements and, you know, everything is coming, it's over-sent. Everybody's on Geiger counters, as I call it, right? So I'm watching people now. I'm like, oh, my God. It almost feels like sometimes I really, truly feel I'm the only human being, you know, in a certain place. Because I'm like, there's no one here aware of being aware. It's really weird feeling. And I feel like I got a good, you know, I can read temperatures better. And I feel like people are so, almost like erratic, you know, they're just like, almost like they don't know, they wouldn't know what to do if it just went boop. And I would probably be there laughing, then like, and they would be probably looking at me and say, why is he crying? It's weird. So I think going back to the question is that I think as visual artists, at some point to make sense of it all, you wanna take the environment, your surroundings, whether it's advertisements or, you know, just things that you find very ironically funny on the street, like the way, you know, Banksy does and a number of other artists that follow Banksy. And you want to make that become something new to feel like you're coming with a new sentence to the talk, you know. And some of it is really beautiful and some of it is really heartfelt, you know. I mean, even if it's very minimal and very bright colors. I mean, there's something really beautiful about having something that makes you feel good or reminds you of something or instigates something. I feel like this movement instigated talent. It instigated appropriation of environment, awareness of environment, and knowing that, like, wow, I'm really in a fucked up situation here. And, you know, where am I going to go? At some point, I said to myself, what am I going to do? And at one point, I said to myself, oh, I'm just going to paint trains for the rest of my life. That's what I thought I really was going to do. And funny enough, Vietnam was in full swing, right? I'm that old. And, you know, I thought that Vietnam was the segue, it was the rites of passage for every young man. As a young kid, I thought that that's what I needed to do. That was my calling to become a man. To actually go to war, survive it, if you could, because you saw it on TV, and that would be my way of, like, coming back to society and being normal. You know, that's really riveting when you think about it. So, you know, I think as young people, we're all very aware of all these little things going on. I don't know if I answered it right, but... but, yeah. I mean, we're aware of environment, yeah.
In times where you felt like you wanted to throw in the towel, because I'm sure as an artist, like, that happens, right? So what are some of the things that have helped you to keep creating work for 40 years? Like, what has gotten you through it?
Wow. Sometimes... There's so many moments like that. I'm just trying to grasp the one. You know, there's many things to be. You know, it's funny. I got a saying that the combination of every color turns to black. If you put every color on earth, it all turns to black. And that blackness, that darkness, is where you find your colors. When you get to that lean moment in your life, both, you know, monetarily. You know, I've eaten oatmeal cookies for dinner. And then the next night I had a filet mignon, you know, because I made a sale. It was those moments that I questioned, like, wow, why is this? Again, like, why am I? But it was, I've learned to live that I got to learn how to suffer. You know, suffer. You know, suffer so that you can come out, you know, take the scales off and rewrite the script, you know, flip the script. And, you know, there's been those moments where, not necessarily from peers, but from the outside world and even the fine arts world, where it wasn't the thing of the moment. And I just felt, okay, this is an intermission. This is an intermission we need to take from each other, walk away, and we'll come back to this. Because I know that I won't go away as far as I'm living, but and my work along with it, but I just feel that when I come back, I'll come back not necessarily to sort of like entertain that group or groups, but I'll come back and just splurge and purge to be an artist at that moment where I feel comfortable in that, and that, you know, wherever that moment is, you know, in my life. So, you know, I don't look at things for one reason only. I look at failure and success for many reasons. And sometimes it's just serendipity, the way things just fall into place and they happen for reasons so that you can reach the next level where you're at, or else you wouldn't know why you're there, right? And I answer that right?
That was good.
Kind of like go all over the place.
Did you say intermission?
Yeah.
Okay, we'll have intermission. No, but he's raised his hand 10 times. So.
Rich, oh, I'm sorry.
Hey, Lee, thanks
yes.
For being generous with your dossier. He was awesome. I bought a tour in here, and he gave an amazing gallery tour, walking around the entire room. And he's like doing it again tonight for us, so thanks for him, Glenn. I have the tricky job of trying to explain street art and fine art to people in the neighborhood. I'm a tour guide as well as an artist. And I talk about street art and graffiti as two poles. Some of the street artists care about what they're called, some of the graffiti artists care about what they're called, and some of them don't. They just do their thing. I just wanted your feedback. How would you explain the difference, or would you not even address it if you were trying to explain street art and graffiti?
When people would say, you know, the G word, as they say, graffiti and all, for a little point in time, I kind of questioned why is that name being attached to what we do. And then I realized that I think really, truly, graffiti is not even a thing. It's actually a state of mind. You know, it really is a state of mind where you know, necessity is the mother of invention, right? So this is like the vehicle, and this is the application methods that we need to use at this point. I just feel like it's really funny. It's a movement without a name. It's like a name, you know, a street with no name, the YouTube film. What? I'm sorry?
I have to talk about it, so I need a name.
Yeah.
Use some word, you know what I'm saying?
I mean, people want to throw, you know, kind of, you know, they want to sprinkle it with all kinds of, you know, post-graffiti, post-pop, post, you know, and, you know, I don't know. I think I'm feeling more comfortable because I can't deny my past, and I will never deny that past. I just look at it as that chapter that I've turned, and I could always go back to, you know, and, you know, whiff off the dust and talk about it again. So I think I feel comfortable now saying that this is, you know, graffitiism is fine. You know, graffitiism, rapid enamelism, whatever you want to call it. You know, I mean, you know, it's one of those untitled titles, you know, where, you know, sometimes an untitled painting tells you more than a titled painting. I love titles, but, you know, untitled sometimes really entitles you to like look at it more, whatever. I don't know. I don't know how to answer that, because those two poles either lean on each other, or they you know, oh, those guys ain't real, or those kids are a bunch of preppies, and it's just like it's kind of funny, it's ironic at the end of the day, you know, because it's like, you know, they're all in the same theater of operations, right? And they're all trying to have a voice, and some are more immediate than others, some are more recreational, you know. But I think when you shake that little nugget net, you know, that net, and you shake all this dirt out, you get those gold nuggets. Those are the ones that have become the artists that will push it to the next moment, you know. So, yeah.
Thank you
very much.
I was like, I used to tell John, I said, call it unauthorized public art.
Real quick. Like I said, I told you, you know, our profile is.